We're on the downhill slide this morning, but we do want to continue the discussion about getting your message out, restoring what's right, and delivering to your county constituents. I'm very fortunate to have with me today this fantastic panel, and each of them has a very unique story and has done something that I find absolutely intriguing to try to help better tell their county story and to better help their constituents know what's going on. So let me introduce to you the panelists that we have this morning. Immediately to my left, we have Judge Anne Marie Carruth from Lubbock County. After her, next to her, we have Judge Tano Tijerina from Webb County.
Thank you.
And then Judge Kim Hoffman from Glasscock County. Sheriff Robert Chody from Williamson County, and he's also my sheriff and may not know that.
Right.
And then the Honorable Beth Rothermel from Washington County. Let's give them a big round of applause. They have each agreed to spend a little bit of time this morning talking to you about what they have done, what they have found useful, and some innovative ideas that they have come up with in their communities. And these are fantastic stories. And we want to start with you, Judge Carruth. Let's talk a little bit about your programs in Lubbock County. And I follow you on social media, so I see a lot of what you do. A lot of what you do seems to be targeted to help the public better understand the court system, the justice court system, and even just the county courthouse as a whole. Can you tell us a little bit about some of your programs?
I had to bring my phone with me because, right, this is our kind of connection to everything. And so I texted a friend of mine this morning and I said, remind me what those stats are on people who use social media. And so I wanted to share those with you first this morning. According to a friend of mine who is in the kind of statistic business of social media, 2.07 billion people are on Facebook, and 46% of them use Facebook right behind Google to be their news source. This is how people are getting their news these days. And so for us, in our office, we realized if this is where people are going to find resources, then we're really doing them a disservice at the local level and through the judiciary when they're looking for ways to self-help. So the way we've done it in our office is to post videos. We try to do one a month on kind of the most frequently asked questions that we get. So raise your hand if you are a judge in the room. How many times, if you're a JP, has someone said, how do I file an eviction? Where can I get an essential needs license? Where do I go to park in the courthouse, right? Or where do I go if I'm parking downtown? And so we took those frequently asked questions, made them into videos, and tried to post one each month so that we can kind of cut down on the mystique, the mysterious nature of the judicial system and what's happening in our office.
Well, since you've talked about your videos, let's go ahead. We have one of those videos I would like for everyone to see. Can we share that video for everyone?
It seems safe on social media, but not here.
Oh,
there it is. Oh, there's no sound.
Okay, well, while we're waiting on the video to play on these screens, let's talk a little bit about some of the posts that you put on social media as well. I know that you spend quite a time answering questions on social media and participating even in a kids' court camp, which I thought was interesting. Can you talk a little bit about those?
So if you're a judge in the room, you know that there are certain rules that we have to go by in terms of ethical standards. And so I definitely do not engage people in terms of answering legal questions because we can't cross that line in our court. So we've tried to be really careful that we're posting things that is informational but not crossing the line as to legal advice. But one way that we have learned to engage younger people in the community was by this court camp. We had our first kind of inaugural court camp this summer. 18 students from across Lubbock County. We had public schools represented, private schools represented, and we took them on a week-long kind of tour of county government. Most of these students say, one day when I grow up, I want to be an attorney. And so this is kind of the goal, and we're setting sort of a foundation for that. But what I realized at the end of the court camp week was so many of them are just interested in local government but didn't realize it. They're interested in law enforcement. Maybe they want to be a court reporter. Maybe they want to work for the sheriff's department, and they just knew it was something legally related, but they didn't realize what options were out there. And so we've tried to engage younger people with programs like this, as well as some award systems that we've done to make sure that they're learning early on the benefit of local government.
Well, congratulations on that. I think it's a fantastic effort, and the feedback that I see is just remarkable on that. Let's try one more time. Can we get the video? Here we go. Here's some of your posts from social media and some really interesting things that you...
Hi, I'm Judge Anne Marie Carruth for Lubbock County Precinct 4, and today I'd like to talk to you a little bit about filing for petitions for eviction in justice court. Petitions for eviction are something that we see in large volume here in Lubbock County, and so I'd like to walk you through the process to help clarify any confusion that you may have. If you visit Precinct 4, there'll be a table outside the court clerk's office with petitions for a variety of different cases. But specifically, of course, we're talking about small claims and landlord-tenant today. The packet that you'll find outside will look like this. There will be a civil case information sheet on the front and then a petition attached to the back that I will walk you through today. This is a state requirement, actually, for the civil case information sheet, so that's why we've already coupled that with the petition for your convenience, and so that will also need to be filled out as well. At the top of the petition, you will first see a case number that the clerk will provide you when you have filed.
All right. Well, great video and such a timely and important topic. I know we get a lot of questions about that.
Thank you for having me.
Let's move on then. Judge Tijerina.
Good morning.
Good morning. You have some fantastic programs going on in Webb County, and it's great to see this type of momentum coming out of your county. Can you talk a little bit about your county government program that you have for the youth in your community?
Absolutely, I appreciate it. And very much like what the judge is doing, it's basically just trying to get the word out of what we actually do. Let's face it, we go to a lot of different places, and what is a county judge? What does commissioner's court do? They have no clue. So we started this program as soon as we came in. I felt that it was very important to educate our future, because I sure don't want to be county judge much longer. We want somebody that's going to be better than us to take over and to be able to take our county and our state to the next level. So we started this program, and I called it the Shadow the Judge program. And basically, we have 8 high schools in Webb County, believe it or not, and most of them are 6A, believe it or not. But one of the things that we noticed was that we were bringing juniors in. And you know, when you have about 16 of these students, and you start asking them the questions, they're clueless on what it's all about. But yet they have an idea of what they want to become, which is really important. Being in county government, as you all know, is that it's very diversified. So you have an opportunity to do different things and become different people. So, you know, for the future. So we take them to those. You want to be an attorney. You want to go and do different opportunities as far as an accountant. We have an accountant, my constable right here, and my PIO. We talk about all that kind of stuff as well. So it gives them an opportunity. But one of the things that I really noticed was that they were really, really not educated on what county government does. So this was our way. They basically are there all day with us. We get to eat lunch with them, and they get to come in, and they get to shadow me for the day. And it's been an eye-opener for most of them, and they really, really, really enjoy it. So that's been a great source of educating our youth. Just like our speaker said a little a while ago, it is the closest that we could get to them, and let's why not be able to communicate and engage with them.
What a fantastic program, and I think we have some slides from that program as well.
I believe this particular shot here, I believe that what we're fixing to talk about too is called, there's the Shadow the Judge program.
They look very judicial.
Yes, they love it. I get people stop me all the time and they just think the world of it. One of the things that we also incorporated was we noticed, okay, so we have a small group called, you know, Shadow the Judge. How can we take this even further? How can we educate our students even further? So, look, my father-in-law said it best one day to me. He said, son, it's not how smart you are, it's who you put around you that that's going to make you a successful man, right? And so I have very, very great people around me to be able to come up with some innovative ideas, and I appreciate that. So one of the things that we decided to do is take Commissioner's Court outside. And how do we do that? Well, first of all, I want to thank TAC, because TAC very much is, I think they're on my speed dial, on my fabs, my fab five, you know, and my phone, because we're always asking them different questions and how we go about it. So Local Government Code 81.005 gave us that opportunity to go ahead and take Commissioner's Court outside and be able to educate it. So we took it to the students. So for the first time ever, Webb County had not only in the courthouse, but we also took it to them. So this year, when we're fixing to pass our budget here pretty quick, we're going to go ahead and set, because government County Government Month is in April, so we're going to go ahead and set those two Commissioner's Court. One, we have two school districts in our community. So one for LISD, one for UISD. We're fixing to have about 1,000 to 1,500 students, just government students, attending those Commissioner's Court. This last Commissioner's Court that we did it at a magnet school. It's called the VMT, Vidal Magnet School. One of the coolest things, and look, I knew that we hit a home run when we did this. My chief executive administrator and I, after the court, we went to Whataburger. Who doesn't love Whataburger, right? So we went to go eat a Whataburger, and as soon as I was about to open the door of Whataburger, there was a young man that came, and he came running, and I was talking to my friend, and he came running in, and he opened the door for me. And I said, "How you doing, young man?" And he said, "Your Honor, it was an incredible educational a commissioner's court that you had, and I attended it, and I want to thank you so much." And I looked at Lalo and I said, he got it. Just because the way he saw it, and he just said, "You inspired me in so many ways." This is what I encourage all of you all to do as well. This is what it's all about. It's truly about educating ourselves and making the right calls and making the right choices. So I want to thank you very much and give me the opportunity to be here today.
Well, thank you for this program. I mean, to hold Commissioner's Court actually in one of your schools is a remarkable idea. I don't know that that's ever been done before, but looking at the slides, it looks like everyone really had a great time, and it sounds like it was quite an educational experience for everyone.
What we tried to do, and I have one of my constables and my auditor as well, what we tried to do during that whole Commissioner's Court is I made it educational. All I did was every single one of them spoke a little bit about what they did, every agenda, how we moved it. Now, you don't make a motion, you move a motion. We started talking a little bit about Robert's Rules of Order and all that good stuff. So they got a little bit out of it.
Thank you for that, and thank you for your service, Judge.
Thank you.
All right, let's move on then. Judge Halfmann, you had a program during Hurricane Harvey that really caught my attention. I thought it was an incredible idea. Can you talk a little bit about that program for us?
Well, I'd be happy to. That's why you invited me here. I finally get to talk. Jim Allison's not up here with me. It's ironic that when I'm looking back at my Facebook and trying to make some notes on what I wanted to kind of touch on today, I coined the phrase hashtag adopt a county actually today, 1 year ago. Obviously, Glasscock County is a very small community in West Texas. We were not affected by Hurricane Harvey, but we heard about it. Pony Express delivered the letter to let me know that there had been an incident on the coast, and people in the community began to talk at the coffee shop, and I was approached about what do we need to do to help. And so when we're talking about Texas Counties Delivers, this is an opportunity to not just deliver to your own constituency. This is about serving mankind. This is about being called upon. So it's not necessarily serving your own county. It's serving the rest of the people we get to breathe this air with. So we had the opportunity to serve some friends of ours. And it's ironic to me also that the people who I worked with most closely, I happened to meet through the TAC leadership program. one of the ladies who I had become friends with was Heather Hawthorne, the Chambers County clerk. And so I picked up the phone, called her, and I said, I know it's nuts. I know you can't talk. What can we do? Call me when you get a chance. And that started the ball rolling. Within 3 days, we had two semi-loads of hay headed to Winnie, Texas, which I'd never heard of Winnie, Texas. Heather called me back and she said, Kim, we don't need help, but my friends in Jefferson County need help. Well, I knew Judge Brannick not very well, just in passing. So once again, I picked up the phone and called and said, what can we do? Call me when you get a chance or have someone else call me. Well, now he has a lovely wife named Sherry, whom I had never met, and she and I had the opportunity to meet a couple months ago, but she and I talked daily. Within 5 days after today's date, we had a cooking crew from our county that loaded up half a beef, 600 chickens. I can't tell you how many pounds of Boston butts we loaded. I can't tell you how many potatoes we washed to send up there, but we sent a crew first to Nederland, and they actually cooked for 24 hours for some of the volunteers. We knew that we were not going to have enough food, that we had not sent near enough. So back home, we were working on trying to get more food and more volunteers to relieve the bunch we sent first. And I get a call from my group, and they're telling me, and it's my, this is how small community we are. It's my brother-in-law, who's also my commissioner. So we have interesting Christmases. It's brought a whole new family dynamic to our family reunions. He calls and he said, Kim, they're asking us to move. And I said, well, are you in danger? And he said, no, there's another need in another area in a town called Bevel Oaks. And from what we understand, it's going to be a very emotional time for these people. They're going to let them into their neighborhoods for the first time since the hurricane. And so they're going to be seeing the devastation and what they're going to have to be dealing with in the aftermath of Harvey. And they want us to set up and serve meals there. And they said, what do you want us to do? And I said, I'm not there. You're going to have to make that call yourself. And he said, we're not going. Well, I know my brother-in-law. He's got a heart as almost as big as me. And he's about 5'3". And I said, Mark, what do you mean you don't want to go? And he said, we promised the National Guard that they'd get some elk, because we had elk that was donated. So they said, we're going to load up and go in the morning, but we're going to fry those guys some French fries and some onion rings and some chicken fried elk before we leave tonight. And we'll load up in the morning and we'll be in Bevel Oaks ready for lunch. They served 600 meals at lunch the next day. In communicating and looking back, we approximate that we served over 6,000 meals while they were there over a week's time. I can't express enough how proud I am of my community for stepping up. This was not within a interlocal agreement. This was volunteers sleeping in a goat trailer for a week, providing services to humanity. And so I'm fortunate that I'm in a community that's willing to serve that way. And I'm even more fortunate to have the opportunity to kind of act as a spearhead and get to kind of direct those guys. They were like a lot of volunteers. They're headed out. They've got truckloads of diapers and tons of water, and they're going to go down and make a difference. But what they learned was if they would pump the brakes a little bit and let me communicate as the emergency management coordinator of my county with other judges to find out what the true needs were, we'd have a bigger impact. I use social media quite a bit to communicate with our county to get additional supplies. It was incredible.
Well, and we saw some of the slides a minute ago they were posting. And a lot of those were your efforts, I think, to keep your community engaged and involved and also calling for help. What was the response within your community to those posts?
Well, when we realized that we were going to have our crew move to Bevel Oaks, they told us to anticipate that we could potentially need to be serving 600 meals a day. So we knew that we had not sent enough food. And crew number two was going to be leaving out within the next 24 hours. So I put a call out on Facebook and made a few phone calls in my office to some of the movers and shakers in our county. And within 3 hours, we had almost 500 pounds of meat donated. We had more fuel than we could shake a stick at. We had pallets of wood delivered. We had Traeger pellets delivered. It was incredible. And to see, we decided we would send food that we had already prepared so that once that second crew got there, they wouldn't have to set up and start cooking. They'd have a meal already prepared. And that would give them an opportunity to get that camp set up, relieve the old crew, let them get on their way home. And so we cooked, I think, 300 chickens that day and I think 250 pounds of barbecue to send with them in coolers.
What a remarkable story, and just the concept of encouraging people to adopt a county and you encouraging other counties to try to do the same was quite impressive, and we thank you for that.
Well, it's I want to give a shout out to ERAF County Commissioner Joe Brown. He was also in our leadership class, and he has made, and I seen sitting back there, I told him I was going to call him out. And I'm going to get tearful, and I'm going to encourage you guys to be a part of TAC leadership because of this. You will be around people that will open your eyes to the different offices in the courthouse, and that's the key, and providing the opportunity for that teamwork and how all those cogs work together to make a successful courthouse. But you're going to make lifetime friends at these conferences, at those leadership opportunities. And when I look at Joe Brown and I hear him on the phone and I hear him giving me praise for being the hands and feet of Jesus, when he's got videos going, he's doing the same thing in ERAF County that I'm doing in Glasscock County, and we're still working together. We sent a trailer load of toys to Chambers County for Christmas. So those efforts haven't stopped because the aftermath of Harvey's still going on. I'm going to pray that we don't have another hurricane, but I can promise you that I'm going to end with this story. Judge Brannick and I were having a conversation when things had kind of calmed down, and he said, Kim, I've pulled out a thank you card and tried to sit down and write a thank you note to you several times, and he says, I don't know how to begin. And I said, well, let me help you get it out. And we're on the phone, and I can hear him rustling around, and he says, okay, I've got it out. And I said, now I want you to tear it up. I don't need a thank you. We did it because it's what Texans do. It's not about a thank you. And one of these days, Glasscock County is going to be on fire, and we're going to not want to eat something that smells like smoke. We're going to want some kind of good seafood. So y'all just load it up, put it in a cooler, and bring it to Glasscock County, and we'll set up at my house where the EOC is.
Thank you so much, and thank you for what you do. Sheriff Chody, You're very active on social media, and your efforts, I think, have really brought new light to your constituents about what goes on in Williamson County, in your office. Can you talk a little bit about some of the efforts that you've made there?
So our goal was to give the law enforcement perspective of what's going on within our organization and how we can utilize these social media platforms to help our community, help us as well. And if I can give some examples. You know, each social media platform brings something different. You know, the younger generation will tell you Facebook is for old people. I found that out about 6 months ago, because I think most people have a Facebook. But what they don't, a lot of people don't have, is a Twitter account, Snapchat accounts, Instagram accounts. And these are the younger generations that law enforcement is dealing with a lot. And understanding that generation, what crime trends are occurring, is helpful to our organization. But when you look at things like Twitter, why do I use Twitter more than Facebook? Is that's the way we can communicate with the media instantaneously. We're letting the media know what's going on with our organization if we have a SWAT call out or something of that matter. It also gives us an opportunity to update traffic events that are occurring, you know, collisions to, you know, stay away from. But when we talk about things like Nextdoor, I don't know how many people are familiar with Nextdoor, but that gives us an opportunity. It's a completely different social media platform that lets us target individual subdivisions. And just yesterday we had a SWAT call out where we were able to identify just that neighborhood and reach anybody signed up in that neighborhood to stay indoors. We have a threat. That's why you see a large presence. We also put it on our Twitter to notify the media. And then we also did a reverse 911 call. So we're trying to utilize these platforms to just better educate, let them know what's going on in our community. And it's paid off dividends at many different levels. But we also bring something different to it, too, I think, is a sense of humor. If you don't know me, I'm almost never serious unless we're at a SWAT call out or something of that nature. But I just, in law enforcement, it's just something I've been able to do. And I take pride in, to be completely honest with you. Some people think that there's no room for that in some aspects, but it's paid off dividends for us, and it's created relationships in our community that have been personal relationships with the younger generation. We developed a relationship with a young boy, a young man who had cancer early on in my administration, 17-year-old, who wanted to be a law enforcement. It all started with a request for a patch that initially I said no to, because we don't just give out patches, but his persistence and what I call just annoyance at that time, I finally sent him a patch. And but then shortly after he was diagnosed, he wasn't diagnosed originally, but it created a visit to the hospital where I have a commander here with me now that we went to Dell's Children's Hospital. Our SWAT team rappelled down off the hospital to near his room. And, you know, it just started a relationship that formed into a personal relationship with my family, his family, and eventually he, you know, succumbed to his illness, but I still talk to his mother today. But it was a great, great experience, and I wouldn't trade it for anything. But it allows us also to show you, the community, what our deputies are doing. You always hear about the negatives. In a law enforcement perspective, I just think it's important that, and I see the picture here, but of this elderly male those deputies right there saved his life. And I think it's important the community knows what our deputies are doing out there, otherwise you won't know. And that's what we try to get. The difficulty for us, though, is sometimes we putting out information so quick, you don't have an opportunity to always vet that information like you would want to. But the media is pretty understanding, the public's pretty understanding. If you're willing to retract it or correct it right away, they're pretty forgiving. But we try to get it right the first time, though sometimes we don't. But it's been a great tool for us.
You've also done some things recently featuring the canine units. Talk a little bit about those, because I think those posts are just absolutely great.
Well, people love animals, and me being one of them, but I have some tools that some people don't, some resources, and a canine unit is one of them. You know, when I first got into office, the culture where I was going into was not very receptive of social media. You know, this is our business, don't tell the world. And we got over those obstacles, but using the canines, it's helped build that bridge with the community. It's helped build a bridge with our own deputies. And now they're almost competing with one another, who can get the best video, the cutest video, who can get the most likes. It's almost juvenile, but it's true. You know, people want to see how many people like their post. I think that includes the panel here. I mean, we all want to be liked. We all want to go viral to some degree. I didn't want to go viral for some of the things I went viral for, but it's gave us a national platform too, and it's validated our agency, in my opinion. We have a great relationship. That's one thing I learned from Chief Acevedo. I don't know if anybody knows Chief Acevedo if you're not from the Austin area, but if you're from Houston now, you should know him. But he was very good creating a relationship with the media here in Austin, and as well as social media presence. And that's where I kind of started watching before I got into office. And I saw the dividends it paid for him, and it gave us that opportunity. Though he didn't use canines, that was my idea. So, but it's worked out very well. And we've had an incident where we had to put down a dog in a situation that we didn't want to. I'm talking about a dog that was attacking a community member, and it was a canine officer that had to do it. And we realized at that point too, that could be, I mean, that's received as a negative, even though they saved the life of a community, that can be seen as a negative. And so we use that opportunity with our canines. People see the relationship we have with our animals at our agency, as well as using it to clear their shelters. You know, we just did that, 2 weeks ago? And it's paid off a lot of dividends, a lot of positive remarks.
Well, we have a couple of your videos. I would like to, if we can cue those up, I would like for everyone to see these videos and see some of the things that you are doing right now. While we're going to that, we have these slides first, though, that leads right into this video.
All right, we're just doing some school zone enforcement. I'm not going to tell you where. You just got to watch out and slow down. We already got two people this morning. And you got to forgive me. I'm the only one out here, so it's a little tough to even pull people over. But the goal is to get compliance and let people see us out here. That way, when they do get a citation, there's no excuse. In reality, there's no excuse now. But we want to remind everybody to slow down. School is in session. And we care about our kids.
And so in that one, tell us a little bit about what you were trying to accomplish with that video.
Well, I think in every community we have issues with school zones, and the parents don't see you out there, teachers don't, or even your own commissioners, they don't see you out there enforcing, why are we giving you resources? This is a way for us to, one, notify the community that we are out there, and I don't want to say shame, but it holds people accountable. Accountability is important. And this is one of many of our school zones in our community. And if I have deputies at three other school zones and I'm at a school zone, even though I may not be enforcing, just the mere fact that I'm videoing and they know that, I'm hopeful, and it has shown to have some response, positive responses, that they know we're out there. They know that's their school zone, because most of the violators are parents, you know. So we're just trying to use that opportunity to make sure they understand that we're out there and showing our commissioners, showing our deputies, showing our community we're doing the job that we said we would. I think that was the first or second day of school that we were out there. That's a recent one, I think.
Okay. I think we have a second video clip then that you also provided us. I want everybody to have a chance to see. Uh-oh, this one could be interesting.
This is not me singing, just so you know.
One way or another, I'm gonna find ya. I'm gonna get you, get you, get you, get you. One way or another, I'm gonna win ya. I'm gonna get you, get you, get you, get you. One way or another, I'm gonna see ya. I'm gonna meet you, meet you, meet you, meet you. One day, maybe next week, I'm gonna meet ya. I'm gonna meet ya, I'll meet ya. I will drive past your house.
I guess obviously that was in response to the cops' lip-sync challenge. That's been
just
all
so you know, I did not know that song. My daughter, you saw her in there, taught me that. We were challenged by the news here in Austin to do that, and we got it initiated here in Williams County. So it was a lot of fun, but that's a little embarrassing to see too, just so you know. But thank you.
So the feedback you've received, obviously excellent in helping humanize your department to your constituents. What value do you find in that?
Well, I mean, when we talk about a shooting or, you know, the community, I feel, trusts us now. I believe the media trusts what we're doing. In fact, we had incidents where we've wanted the media, we're very good in our criminal interdiction here. We have a major thoroughfare, Interstate 35, and we've received large loads of money from illegal, you know, seizures, not illegal seizures on our part, but we've seized large amounts of money. And we don't necessarily want the public to always know about that due to the cartel issues, the safety of the deputies. And there was one specific case where we just did a seizure, and one of the main media outlets here in Austin contacted us. And We were like, how did they know that? We didn't put that out. We're still investigating. We have a person that's involved in the case that they potentially could be harmed if they know they're cooperating with us. So when the media came out with that information, first time I ever asked the media to hold on to something. She had to clear it through her editor, of course, but they were very willing to just not do the story at all, which was a big story because it was a large amount of money. So it pays off a dividend when you need something like that. And in this case, it did. It helped get the case to the next level so we could do a proper, you know, prosecution and protect the deputies as well as the people involved in the case that aren't in law enforcement. So that was just one advantage for us. If I can tell you another quick advantage, when we talk about Nextdoor, the social media platform, as commissioners and community members, taxpayers, and even as a sheriff, when we used Nextdoor, we had an occurrence where a young juvenile was out. We couldn't post a picture of the juvenile, but this juvenile was missing, and we had a concern for the health and safety of this juvenile. The mother was very concerned. There was reasons why. But we posted on Nextdoor just that area. If you see this young person, please let us know. I already had deputies in that area for 30 minutes looking for this young person. And so the resources we were utilizing, we had drones getting deployed to look for this. It was just getting ready to turn nighttime. So the fire department was starting to come, and a lot of money from a county's perspective, including my budget. And once we posted, it was our first experience with Nextdoor where we used it in this fashion. Once we posted on Nextdoor, within 10 minutes, we had community members saying, I just saw that young man over here. And then before I knew it, one of our deputies was flagged down by a community member in this area who has Nextdoor. And we were able to quickly find the child, confirm that he was safe, bring him home, get him the help he needed. And the resources were able to go back and take calls for service and not take more resources to find this. So it was very helpful from a large perspective.
Thank you for what you do, Sheriff. That's amazing.
Thank you, and I encourage you to follow us at Sheriff Chody on Twitter and Facebook and Instagram.
All right. Well, Beth, congratulations. You recently won a County Best Practices Award for your publication. Tell us a little bit about this project.
Thank you. Well, like a lot of projects, it starts out simple, and it winds up being something completely different, and it grew into a 77-page booklet on county government that we hope will be sort of the go-to informational spot for all things county government. It started out, I just wanted to make a list of the county clerks that had served. I thought that would be kind of a cool thing to possibly get that list and maybe have a plaque made and honor the folks that had served as county clerk. About that time, our former court at law judge came along and asked me if I could make a list of the county judges that had served. And I thought, well, why not do everybody? So I had about 13 bond record books to read through and about 6 election record books and researched county commissioner's court minutes and spent about 2 years researching all the background. So there's a list of folks that have served each seat of county government. And I ask each department head if they would write a little bit about their office. So each page is different and unique, written in their own words. And I asked them also for pictures of themselves. And that was the most challenging part because I had to chase them down. I had to bag them a little bit. But everybody came through in the end, and they made their pages their own. And then I decided to add a little bit of history. I thought, what would people want to know about Washington County? Washington County is the birthplace of Texas independence. It's where the Declaration was signed on March 2nd, 1836, at Washington on the Brazos. We call it Old Washington now. And in the inception of Washington County, the county was quite large. It went all the way over to San Jacinto County, which I think of as deep East Texas, took in most of Walker County, Brazos County, and then part of Lee County. So it was quite a large area. And so I incorporated a picture of that, as well as when those other counties were farmed and that land was chiseled off of Washington County. I also added census data, statistical data, some demographic data. It sort of took on a life of its own. And along the way, my county auditor, Sharon Stoltz, offered to bind it for me. So they were gracious enough to be my proofreader and made sure everything was sort of looking good on the page and giving me some tips on how to do things. The final thing that got added was Commissioner Haneth came to me and asked if we could figure out when the county voted, the commissioner's court voted to grant the discount on payment of property taxes. And we knew it was about a five-year period, I think. We'd narrowed it down to that, you know, period of time in the 1980s. And so he and I started looking, and then I thought to myself, there's no place where there's a comprehensive list of tax rates. And people might find that interesting to know what the tax rate was years ago. So the very last thing that I added was back to 1867, all the tax rates. So it was just really interesting. The more I found, the more I wanted to include, the more I wanted to put in there as a way to help folks. And I delivered one to each of our departments, offices in the county, as well as the local media, the local newspaper, the radio station, the local library, and I put it on our website. So anywhere I could think of that people might go to want to know who served in an office, what that office does, and some interesting information about our county.
That is fantastic. So do you have plans to sell the books to community members, give them away? What are you going to do with them?
We do have them available in our office. For anybody that wants to come in and get one, at this point, no plans to sell it as of now. However, there may be a market. What do you think, commissioners? Lower the tax rate a little bit if we sell these.
Supplement your budget.
But anyway.
So with this, what's the feedback been?
Great, absolutely great. The people that have looked at it have said they just had no idea and just were amazed at the information in it. And when offices were formed, how far back all of the commissioners went, even parts of the county that I guess they must have been called different things, different community names that no longer exist. And that's another thing I'm thinking I might want to look back, and I think that's going to involve going into old newspapers and looking at that and doing some research. But I think I got more out of it than anyone because I just learned so much more about our county, and it just made me just extremely proud and fortunate to live in Washington County.
That is fantastic, and what a great educational tool. Thank you for doing that, and thank you for sharing with us.
Thank you.
Sure. So I think what we can all take away from this is that there are a variety of ways that you can reach out to your constituents and educate them through video, through instructional videos, by humanizing your department, by reaching out and helping other counties, by giving them more information on your county. The possibilities are really endless. And I want to thank the panelists for sharing your stories with us today, and thank you so much for your service to counties. We truly appreciate everything each of you do.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, so while our panel is making their way back to their seats, we want to turn the spotlight to you for a few minutes. As we get ready to close out today's session, we heard five fantastic stories here. Does anyone else have a story, something that you have done unique or innovative to share your county's story or to help educate your county and your community? We have microphones set up. If anybody would like to have open mic, or if nothing else, so we could always participate in the Sheriff's Lip Sync Challenge. Anybody have any ideas you want to share? Okay, we've got some people making their way to the microphones. We're anxious to hear because, I mean, you learn best from hearing from your peers. So, yes, ma'am.
Hi, good morning. Melissa Shannon, Bexar County. Mine's not very innovative. It's grassroots. But with the unfunded mandate cards, the postcards that we got from TAC, I ordered them for all the county commissioners in the judge's office, and they each put them in their office. And I've got two commissioners who actually have what we call satellite offices, and one in particular shares an office with our tax office satellite and JP and Constable. So there's a lot of traffic coming through there. Commissioner Rodriguez put the cards out, and lo and behold, one day I get a call from Rick Thompson. A gentleman had picked up the card, and he wanted more to pass out. And I think Rick, he owned a travel trailer park resort type of business in Bexar County, and he wanted to share the cards with his association. So by golly, I ordered more cards and got them promptly to him. I apologize, I should have followed up with him before this meeting to find out how that went, but it was something just very simple, just sharing out in the community. And as we know, we keep hearing tax reform, and our constituents are very interested in that, and he was quite interested and wanted to share with his membership. So something very simple to do.
That's what a great idea, and thank you for doing that, and thank you for sharing those cards. Is there anyone else that has something that you have done that you would like to share, or even an idea you have other counties might be interested in? Okay, we've got someone coming to the microphone. After this, we will wrap up and try to get you out of here so you can beat traffic on your way home.
Good morning, Bridget Shea, Travis County Commissioner, Precinct 2. Welcome to Austin. We are working through my office, but also with our Sheriff's Department, our Emergency Services Department, our emergency, our ESDs, our Parks Department, and with community volunteers who live in a neighborhood that is, well, it's somewhat isolated, but you can only access it by a long, windy, one-way-in, one-way-out road. And they're surrounded by park and preserve land. So they know that they are in danger of wildfires. And we've been working with them since last year and are hoping eventually this fall to actually run a pilot project that we've been creating with them for a neighborhood fire drill and evacuation plan. We looked all over to see if there were any other models for neighborhood fire drills. We all have fire drills at school, we have fire drills at work, but we couldn't find many models for a neighborhood-based fire drill. And no pun intended, but the neighborhood's on fire about this. They're very excited about getting some tools to be able to learn what to do because they're kind of trapped at the end of this long one-way-in, one-way-out road. If the fire truck's coming down the road, no cars are getting out past it because the road's barely wide enough for the fire truck. So hopefully we'll have something to report back next year because we do intend to run the exercise this fall. But these are some of the kind of things we're trying to do in Travis County because we know we don't have enough first responders. We don't have enough people to rescue everybody, so we've got to give people the tools to help them know what to do to get themselves out of harm's way.
Thank you for sharing, Commissioner, and we look forward to hearing how that program worked out. Is there anyone else? All right, I think everybody is probably ready to go home. I would want to take a minute and once again thank the panelists, thank all of those that shared your stories in our Texas Counties Deliver Story booth this week. Those stories will be available on our website. So please check back to those and take a look at those and share this information. We don't just do this just so we can talk about it once a year. We want you to have this information so you can take it out and share. It never ceases to amaze me how little people know about what Texas counties do, which is so, why it's so important for you to get out, share your story, talk to the people in your community, urge them to access the websites, the materials, and let's help people know more what we do. Going into this next legislative session, I think it's going to be more important than ever before. So please take advantage of these great tools we have available. As we close out, Please do not forget that the legislative session is right around the corner. We will be counting on each of you to help us out. We appreciate the fact that when we call, you come running to help. That, as Judge Hoffman said, that's just what Texans do. And we really appreciate it. We look forward to working with you this session. As a reminder, we will be back here next year for the legislative conference. We're actually going to give, now that Gene is retiring, we're going to give him his anniversary off. We're going to actually, the conference will be September 4th through 6th. You'll be getting information when registration opens. We hope you come back, and hopefully by then our war wounds from the session will be licked and we'll be ready to throw a big party to celebrate. So we look forward to seeing you there. Please be safe on your way home. And as always, if you need anything, TAC is here to help. Don't hesitate. Call us anytime. God bless, Godspeed, and we'll see you next year.